Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we are talking about the Ford Flathead V8 engine, and it's a pretty neat engine. We're going to be getting into a bit of how it works and ultimately why it died off in the year I was born, 1953. Now this is a super cool engine. It was introduced in America in 1932 in the Ford Model 18, and it was really the first mass-produced V8 engine entering the market. So you could say it started our obsession in America with V8 engines, which that lust has certainly never died. Still super passionate about V8 engines, though the style has changed quite a bit. Now this is a later model Ford Flathead V8 engine. It's a bit larger than the original. The original was a 3.6 liter V8 and it had a compression ratio of just 5.5 to 1 and produced 65 horsepower, which, you know, you may think is a bit embarrassing out of a 3.6 liter V8, but you know, this is back in the day, 90 years ago, when they didn't even have computers. So it's pretty wild how sophisticated this engine actually is for its time. It's pretty cool, and it had a lot of advantages, especially from a cost perspective, that allowed it to enter the mass market. Okay, so let's get into how this engine works first, and we'll just start disassembling it and kind of dive into it. So up top we have the air filter fed through the carburetors into the intake, which then passes into the engine and then out the exhaust. You can see those middle two cylinders share an exhaust exit, whereas each of the outside cylinders have their own individual exit. So we'll go ahead and take these wires off, which are igniting those spark plugs. You can see the four spark plugs right there. And so why it got the flathead name, here's the engine cylinder head. So extremely simple, basically just one piece of metal. And that really helped with the cost of it because the cylinder head was not complicated at all. All of it could be cast into a single block where you have your intake and exhaust valves, as well as your pistons. In front, we of course have this cooling fan. You've got a generator and then the distributor right here in red, which is going to be sending the ignition to each individual spark. Go ahead and turn this off and remove our intake. So there's our air filters. Here we have the intake. Pull that off. So pretty fascinating looking at the actual operation of the intake and exhaust valves, as well as the pistons. So you've got a single camshaft located in the center of the V, which is operated by the crankshaft, geared of course 2-to-1. So two rotations of the crankshaft for every rotation of that camshaft, which is opening these intake and exhaust valves. Now you've got the same basic four strokes as any other engine. So there was your intake stroke pulling down, compressing that air and fuel mixture, power stroke as that piston goes back down, and then pushing out through the exhaust. You can see that exhaust valve opening up there, and then the cycle repeats itself. So pretty cool. You can actually see the operation of those valves by the camshaft here within the engine. And you've got those two exhaust valves shared in the center there, which port out through that center exhaust. And then these will actually come down the sides and through the exhaust versus your two intake ports right here. You know, so it's actually shortening, making that path simpler. And you've got these cylinders offset a little bit so that single camshaft can operate each individual valve. So none of the two valves actually line up directly. So perhaps it's a bit obvious looking at it now, but it's a real simple design. And part of that simplicity is beautiful, leads to reliability, and, you know, helps this engine come in at an affordable price point where it can be marketed in a mass production vehicle and actually, you know, sold out to the everyday common person. And so that's really the beauty of this engine, is that it could bring the V8 to everyone, not just, you know, really expensive performance cars. So that's really the advantage of it. And it actually did have decent low end, you know, lower RPM power. But as you might imagine, the downfall of this really comes down to airflow and efficiency. Because it isn't really optimized for good airflow or good efficiency. And so we're going to get into the reasons for both of those. Okay, so first let's just get into the airflow. And the airflow path is not ideal in this situation. So you've got your air, it's going to be coming in right here, then feeding up. So it's going to go up this direction. Then it has to change 90 degrees, and then it has to change another 90 degrees and go down into the cylinder. Rather than, you know, on today's engines, the airflow goes towards the piston, out around it, and then down into the cylinder rather than making a 180 degree turn. Now it has to do the exact same thing when that air is on its way back up. So it comes up the cylinder, goes that 90 degree angle, and then out the exhaust. So again, the airflow situation here is not ideal just based on the path that the air has to travel versus today's modern engines. The other challenge challenge with airflow is that your intake and your exhaust flow is in opposite directions. So after your power stroke, you're pushing that air out the exhaust and your airflow is traveling this direction. So that exhaust valve starts to close and your airflow is going in this direction. Then your intake valve opens and suddenly you're reversing that airflow into the cylinder. Versus in today's modern engines, that airflow is in the same direction. So the intake air comes in, and then as it exits the exhaust air is traveling in the exact direction that the intake air is going to be entering in. And so you have that nice scavenging, that nice airflow exit, where it's a smooth transition from exhaust to intake rather than having them collide with one another and act in opposite directions. Now the airflow challenges don't end there, because as you can see, if the air is coming in from this intake valve right here and it all needs to travel this direction, the air that comes in on this side of the valve on the top there has to completely change around. So it's kind of ideal from this end where it can just come right out and then go into the cylinder, but really that's the face where all of that airflow has to flow in. On this side of the valve, on this top portion here, if it were to come out there, then it's got to go up around the side of the valve and then back down into the cylinder. So it's very challenging from a design standpoint. It's much more ideal in today's engines to have that valve over the cylinder where the airflow can go completely around the valve and into the cylinder, rather than, you know, just having a portion of it where the airflow is ideal. Okay, well, if airflow isn't great, then why don't we just open these intake and exhaust valves more? Just push them open more so that you can have more flow in. Well, the challenge with that is it means you have to dig out more of this cylinder head. So the more of this cylinder head that you remove to allow for space for these valves to have clearance and open up and provide airflow, then the lower your compression ratio is going to be, because this is to the side of your piston. So the larger this volume here to the side of your piston, the less you can compress the overall volume of that cylinder, because you've got this big volume above the valves. So if you want to improve the compression ratio, it often means you're reducing the amount of clearance that your valves have to open and close. So you're further impeding airflow at high RPM. So really, you know, the battle to make this thing efficient and flow well is a losing fight, because you can't have a high compression ratio and high RPM airflow, and you can't have high airflow with a high compression ratio. Both of them fight against each other. So one of the final versions of the Ford Flathead V8 was a 3.9 liter, very similar to what you see here. It had a compression ratio of 7.2 to 1 and produced 110 horsepower. But how do you improve how much power this engine makes? Well, you get rid of it and you switch to an overhead valve design. And that is what Ford did in 1954. So this thing died out in 1953, producing about 110 horsepower. And then the next year, with their overhead valve design with the same displacement, they were able to improve how much power the engine created. So a huge shout out to Eric Harrell for lending me this beautiful 3D printed engine. I will include links to this in the video description. And thank you all for watching. If you have any questions or comments, of course, feel free to leave those below, and I'll include some relevant links to other videos you may find interesting if you enjoyed this one.